everybody, and welcome back to another episode of Inside Number 23, my channel, which is all about knitting and sewing and generally living the craftiest life possible. My name is Katie, and you can find me pretty much everywhere on the interwebs and social media in general as Miss Lavelli. We also have a Ravelry group for the podcast, which you can search, you can find rather by searching Inside Number 23 on Ravelry. And if you need to contact me regarding anything to do with the podcast, please feel free to drop me an email. The email for the podcast is katie@insidenumber23.com. Now, I am coming to you as always from Hertfordshire, which is just north of London in the UK, where I live with my husband Emrys and our lovely pug puppy Rolly and our bump. We are expecting a baby October, November kind of time, so that's all very exciting. And it's just really great to be back with you for another podcast this week. It's a little bit later in the week than I usually upload, so apologies for that to my long-term viewers. I've been very, very busy over the past week, but I still wanted to get an episode up for you because I have a lot of fun things to share. Excitingly as well, this is actually episode 99 of the podcast, which means that the next episode that I upload is episode number 100, which is obviously because 99 comes before 100, but it's very, very exciting, and I'm absolutely thrilled. Thank you to everybody who has maybe watched 100 episodes of this podcast, my goodness. And on that note, to all of my long-term viewers, hello my lovelies, it's so nice to be back with you again. And if this is your first time watching, then hello and welcome, and I hope that you enjoy your time with me this week. Excitingly, I have done some interesting things over the past couple of weeks. I recorded my first ever audio podcast, which was a really exciting experience. I was invited by the lovely ladies of the Stitchers Brew podcast, and I recorded that with lovely Rosabella, who has a YouTube channel, Sewn. So it is, I believe, episode number 25 of the Stitchers Brew podcast, which you can find on iTunes podcasts or Stitcher or pretty much everywhere that you get audio podcasts. So do check that out. Stitchers Brew is a really, really lovely podcast. It's very, very fun. Megan and Gabby, who host, were amazing, and they are lovely to listen to, so I'd very much recommend it. And thank you, ladies, for having me on your podcast. It was so much fun. So yes, go and check that out. Before we kind of get into what I've been making this week, which is quite a lot, I wanted to talk briefly about the S-along, which I mentioned in my last episode of the podcast. Now, the S-along is a shawl knit along from this incredible book. This is Marlisle by Anna Maltz, whom I adore. I think she is wonderful, and I'm so excited about knitting this shawl. It will be, the knit along will be starting at the beginning of September and just running throughout that month. There it is, isn't it gorgeous? And I know that a lot of you were very keen to get involved. One thing that I didn't realise when I started up the knit along is that the pattern is actually unavailable as a single download. It's only available as part of the collection, which is actually only available in book form. You do get a PDF download with the book, but you cannot purchase one without the other. So basically they come as a set. You buy the book and then you can have the PDF download with it, which is not something I was aware of when I started up the knit along. So apologies for that. What I would say, if you're going to buy a book, this book is a really, really good one to buy. I adore it. I pretty much want to knit almost everything that's in here. But I do appreciate that investing in a whole book for a short knit along may not be something that a lot of you are super keen to do. So I will still be doing the knit along. It was always going to be super kind of casual, and also it's based primarily on Instagram rather than in the Ravelry group. It's very relaxed, it's very kind of open and fun. So I will still be doing it, and I hope that some of you will get involved. But if it ends up being just a small thing, we may not do prizes or that type of thing. It may just be for the fun of it, but if you do get involved, fantastic. But I appreciate that it may not be something that a huge amount of you want to get involved in because of the expense of buying a whole collection. But as I have said now a couple of times, this book is probably my favourite book that I purchased in this last year. I absolutely love it and I couldn't recommend it more highly. So if you are going to buy a book, this is a good one. But yes, that will be kicking off on September 1st. And hopefully I will be sharing my yarn and everything in the lead up to that. I'm very, very excited about it. So yay. autumn is definitely on its way, which is wonderful because it's been so warm here in the UK, as I keep saying and going on and on and on about, but it has been very, very warm. And the last few days we've had some rain, we've had some cooler mornings, and I can just tell that we're on the cusp of autumn and it's making me incredibly happy, and therefore casting on said shawl will also be part of the autumnal celebration, so yay for that. Okay, I think it's time that we crack on with what I have been working on for the past week. It's kind of a funny week this week because all of a sudden I have been completely and utterly overcome with a need to sew everything. I have had a very heavy sewing filled week, which has been wonderful, but it has meant that the knitting has suffered slightly. There hasn't been as much knitting, so this is definitely a sew heavy, sewing heavy podcast this week, but it tends to go that way with me. I'm either one or the other, I find. But I'm going to start off this week by talking about what I am wearing, because very excitingly, this is a project that I actually finished. I believe I shared it with you completed in my last episode, or maybe the episode before. I can't keep track of the days anymore, but I blocked this beautiful sweater. This is the White Horse sweater by Caitlyn Hunter, who is also known as Boyland Knitworks, and I am so happy with how this sweater has turned out. It is wonderful. I think one of the reasons I like it so much is it kind of harks back to the more vintage styling that I really, really loved for a very long time. But that's kind of gone out of my wardrobe slightly now. But this, oh my goodness, it is everything. So the White Horse sweater, for those of you who do not know, let me just pop up so I can show you in slightly more detail. It has a beautiful lace yoke, which also has all these little bobbles on it, which I kind of tried to make more pronounced when I was blocking. It is not centered, the lace panel. So basically the center of the sweater is here and this is the lace repeat, which is fully intentional. I didn't make a mistake, I promise. And then the rest of the sweater is done in reverse stockinette stitch, but it's actually knit inside out. So you just knit the whole thing. You don't have to worry about multiple purl stitches, but yes, I love it. Is this lace not one of the prettiest things that you've ever seen? I wouldn't say that I'm a huge lace knitter, but this sweater most definitely has converted me to lace knitting. It's a DK weight sweater, and the yarn that I used is this beautiful non-dyed BFL Masham blend that I picked up from Laxtons Limited at Edinburgh Yarn Festival a few years ago, and I love it. It is an incredibly comfortable sweater to wear. I really, really love the colour of it. And it kind of reminds me in a weird way of like oatmeal cookies because of the colour. It's kind of this browny grey, which I really, really, really love. It's a really nice kind of neutral that goes with pretty much everything, which is fantastic, obviously, but it's just divine. I love it. And it knit up incredibly quickly. I think it took me a total of 8 days to knit this whole sweater. I was very, very obsessed with it when I was knitting it, but I think that's pretty good for a sweater. But yes, it's fully blocked. It smelt amazing when it was blocked because it is just the natural yarn, the BFL and the Masham blend, without anything else, so it still had a lovely sheepy smell when it was being blocked, and that made me very, very happy. But yes, I just love it. Also, it's a cropped length, so it's currently working well with the baby bump, which is good because I am going to be having this bump for at least a couple more months, fingers crossed. I don't want the baby to come too early. But it works well with bump, and I have been assured that cropped sweaters work well with babies as well, in terms of convenience for breastfeeding and all of that good stuff. You know, let's get into the details of life after all. You know, we're all human. So I'm really thrilled. I think it's going to last a long time. And the nice thing about this yoke is the flexibility of it. I think if my body is going to change a lot after having the baby, you know, things can get bigger, things can shrink. It's still going to have a lot of wearability because of the flexibility of the lace, and also I can just re-block the body if it stretches out a little bit too much, just give it a little soak and just pat it down, so once it is no longer being stretched over a bump, it's not going to be all stretched out of shape beyond recognition. But yes, I am really, really, really happy with it, and the blocking just worked absolute wonders on it. I'm so thrilled that I took the time to really block it properly, because when it comes to lace, you don't want to kind of take any shortcuts really, just because it's bloomed and opened up and it looks so much prettier. It looked a little bit lumpy just before I blocked it, but yes, in case you don't know, I love this sweater and would very highly recommend that you also knit one. Talking about blocking, before I get on to what I've actually been knitting this week, I did want to share another project that I've just finished blocking. I've been on a bit of a house organisation kick at the moment. I've been going through pretty much everything in every part of the house and reorganising and making sure that everything's ready, because I know that in a few months, once the baby is here, I'm not going to have a huge amount of time to do that. And it's been a really amazing experience. I have loved it so far. I do love a little bit of organisation. But I discovered this sweater, which I actually finished a while ago, but I had never blocked it. Now, you may or may not remember this lovely sweater. This is the Channa sweater. And I knit this just before Edinburgh Yarn Festival this year. It was kind of my Edinburgh Yarn Festival sweater, I guess. And I love this pattern. This yarn was ripped out of a couple of projects before it became this project. This is actually yarn by the Wool Kitchen. It's in their DK weight BFL yarn in the Champagne Supernova colourway, and as you can see, it's covered in these lovely little neon pops of colour. I love this sweater so much. It's like a funfetti cake, basically, and it's amazing. But I finished this in time for Edinburgh Yarn Festival, but I never had time to block it before I wore it at the festival. And funny story, whilst I was wearing this sweater, I felt so ill at Edinburgh Yarn Festival because it was right at the beginning kind of my first trimester of pregnancy, and I felt awful. And wearing this, although it did kind of perk me up a little bit, it kind of reminded me of that feeling of morning sickness and just generally feeling horrendous. I felt so vile in whilst I was in Edinburgh, so I'm really sorry to anybody who talked to me and I seemed a bit off colour, because I really, really was. But that basically meant that when we got back from Edinburgh, this got packed away because the temperature started increasing anyway, so I wasn't really going to be wearing a double knit sweater at that time. But I just never got around to blocking it, and I thought, well, as I'm blocking this sweater, why not do two for the price of one? So I've also now blocked the Channa sweater, and I'm really, really happy with how it is looking. The blocking has kind of opened up the detail of the raglan sleeves, which is really pretty. There's a little slip stitch detail there that I think is lovely on the back and also on the front, and it's also kind of opened up the interrupted garter that goes across the entirety of the front of the sweater. It has a dropped hem, so it's slightly longer at the back, which is a style that I absolutely love. And excitingly, it does currently fit me with a baby bump, which is nice because it means that once the temperature drops, I will be able to wear this. So that's good. I must admit, it does... it's a little tight around the bump, and because of all of the stripes, it does kind of make me feel a bit like a glowworm, which is an interesting feeling. It's not the most flattering of looks, but I love the sweater so much that it's nice to know that I can wear it now if I want to, and obviously if I'd rather not feel like a glowworm on a particular day, I can also just wear it afterwards. But yes, it's lovely. It also smells amazing. I love how all of my sweaters smell after they've been blocked, because I always use kind of handmade wool washes and that type of thing to give them a lovely scent. But yeah, finally did that, which is incredibly exciting and just nice to feel organized and like I'm getting everything squared away. So enough about sweaters that I have been blocking, let's talk about the projects that I have been actually knitting on over the past week or so. Now, I have been a bit of a monogamous knitter this week, which is a bit different for me because, as you'll probably know from previous episodes, the last couple of episodes at least, I have had several projects on the go, lots of finished objects, lots of baby projects and that type of thing. But this week, it's all been on one project, and it's a project that you have all seen before, and that is, of course, my Breathing Space sweater. Breathing Space is a pattern by Vera Valimaki, and I realised, I think I said in a previous episode that I've never knit a Vera Valimaki pattern before, which is a huge lie because I've knit her Pavement sweater and I really, really love that sweater, so just ignore me that I said that I haven't knit one of her patterns before, because I have, but I am currently on Sleeve Island with this project. Now, I had cast on my first sleeve when I last shared this with you, and I am happy to say I have one completed sleeve! Huzzah! Hurrah! Hooray! And I'm really, really happy with how it's looking. This yarn, as I've shared with you before, is Travel Knitter yarn in the Tanami base, which is a 50-50 blend of baby camel and silk, so it's incredibly luxurious and soft and gorgeous and silky against the skin. And the two colours that I have picked are the kind of burgundy colour, which is English Damson, and then the blue-grey colour, which is Puddled Iron. So I have completed the first sleeve, very excitingly, and I am currently still plodding away on the second sleeve. I'm on the decreases, and to be honest, it's actually slightly easier with the second sleeve because I wrote down exactly the amount of rows that I did with the first one, so I'm just following that exactly now. So hopefully this will be finished soon. It is becoming a little laborious, and I think that's because I do have quite a lot of sweater works in progress that I would really, really like to get off the needles before the baby gets here, just because I don't want to have loads of massive projects hanging over me by the time that they're born. And Sleeve Island is getting a little frustrating. I think it's also because when I was working on the body, let me just show you that again because it hasn't made an appearance for a while. When I was working on the body of the sweater, these rows were a lot longer, so the striping didn't feel too laborious because you're going all the way around and then all the way around again in one colour. So it's a lot of kind of mindless knitting away, which is great if you're watching TV or having a chat or listening to podcasts and that type of thing. But now that I'm on the sleeve, because it's such a smaller circumference, you do kind of have to be a little bit more alert because you're changing colour a lot more frequently than when you were knitting on the body of the sweater. And it is going to be glorious when it's finished. I love how this sweater feels. I love the colour. I mean, it's covered in roly hair at the moment, as most of my knitwear is, but it's beautiful, and it's going to just fit like a dream, I know, and be so comforting and so easy to kind of throw on. And I'm very, very excited about having it finished. But this sleeve, I need to just, I think that's why I haven't allowed myself to kind of work on anything else or cast on anything new, even though I do want to cast on new things because I have startitis like you wouldn't believe. I think that's maybe why I've been focusing more on sewing, because I can crank sewing projects out a lot more quickly than I can knitting projects. So it's kind of appealing to that startitis that is still going on in the back of my brain. But I have to be monogamous on this, I think, at the moment, just because I know that in a little bit I want to cast on, obviously, my S shawl for the S along, and I am very, very tempted to pick up either my Michelle Wong cardigan that I've been working on, or my Soiree sweater that needs finishing. There are lots of projects that need love and attention that I need to kind of get done as soon as possible. So I'm going to try my very, very best to get this finished, fingers crossed, within the next couple of days, definitely by the next time that I podcast, but we'll see, because I tend to set myself goals and then fail miserably once I've set them. But yes, I still love this pattern. I think it's wonderful. I totally understand why everybody has knit one, and I would just like to have one to wear now. So please, lovely, lovely sweater, be finished soon. I just need to watch more episodes of The Great British Bake Off and just knit sleeves. And thank you, by the way, to everybody else who is currently residing on Sleeve Island with me. I feel like we have a little support group that's been going on in Instagram, kind of offering each other condolences about being on Sleeve Island with projects. So thank you for all of the support from everyone else who is in a similar position. I feel your pain, and we just have to persevere, and soon we will have some lovely projects finished if we can just stick with it. So big thumbs up to all of you guys who are with me on Sleeve Island. That's everything I've been knitting on this week. I told you it had not been a particularly knit heavy week, because it's all about the sewing. It's all about the sewing this week. It really, really is. And I'm very happy about this, because I felt like my sojo was absolutely in the toilet, and although my knitting mojo well and truly has come back after leaving the building for what was essentially about 4 to 5 months where I didn't knit anything, my sewing mojo, my sojo, it took a little bit more time to catch up, and now I just feel like 100% I am back in the zone, and I am really, really happy and excited about the things that I'm working on. So without further ado, let me share with you a pretty exciting project that's brought me huge amounts of joy over the past week. You may have seen a few details of this on Instagram, on my stories, because I did share what I was working on. Oh, I'm so happy with this. Now, I can't remember exactly how much of this I shared on my last episode, but basically I have been working on the cami dress, which is a pattern by Pauline Alice, and hilariously, she first of all published a kind of maternity hack on her blog to work with the original pattern. But then a couple of weeks ago, after I'd already started this project, kind of doing the hack myself, she republished the pattern with the hack included as a variation on the pattern. So it was all very funny, and but I have made it work. So so yeah, that's a bit of a tangent for you. Also, if you have purchased her pattern, by the way, before she introduced the second version into it, if you go to your downloads on her website, you can download the new version. So they are providing it, the updated version, to people who have already purchased the pattern. So basically, if I ever want to make this dress again, but using the kind of maternity hack version, it was basically just kind of an empire line, slightly more relaxed version of the dress, I can just use the pattern now. So fabulous customer service, Pauline Alice. I'm very, very impressed. But I think that I shared with you that I'd been working on the bodice And I had put my little cuffs in. I think I had shown you the cuffs before, but just in case I hadn't, I have these lovely white cuffs in contrast to this gorgeous blue chambray fabric. Now, the blue chambray was purchased from John Lewis in their sale. I love it so much. I think it looks beautiful. And it's a slightly off-white, very, very soft cotton that I have used for the cuffs. And that was just in stash. But I love the contrast between the cuff and the sleeve. I think it's just the sweetest thing. But the thing that has been taking up the majority of my time over the past week has been, and this really does deserve some kind of a drum roll or something because I'm so happy with it, but it is my collar. Look at this. Oh my goodness. I can't tell you how excited I am about this collar. So I spoke briefly about wanting to do some embroidery on the collar of this dress. Embroidered collars are something that I have done previously with other projects. The Blue A dress, which is a pattern by Deer and Doe that I have made, I think, 4 different versions of. It's something that I absolutely love. I made a cat version of that dress with little cats embroidered on the collar, and to this day it's one of my favourite makes that I've ever made. I absolutely love that dress. And I was missing a little bit of kitsch, a little bit of fun in my sewing, and I decided that I wanted to embroider something special on the collar of this dress. Now, this kind of had a bit of an evolution, I guess, in terms of why it ended up being this particular icon that I've got on here. Originally, I was thinking about just doing simple hearts embroidered on the collar. I think the combination of the navy blue, the white and the red was just perfect, and I wanted to go for something maybe a little more simple. I then thought about hearts with arrows through them, something really cute and kitschy. And then I remembered this crying heart motif. So let me show you this again. This is a kind of little crying heart motif. And for those of you who have an interest in tattoo culture, particularly more old school traditional tattoos, this is probably a symbol that you have seen before. There are a lot of tattooists who, with their flash, have produced images that are this really, really beautiful symbol, which is basically a heart crying tears. I don't really know anything about the history of it. I just know that it's one of those traditional symbols that appears throughout tattooing history. And I've always really, really loved it. I think it looks very feminine and pretty. It's something that I've considered getting tattooed myself in the past, but I tend to go for more kind of interesting, unique ideas rather than super, super traditional things with at least the tattoos that I currently have. But I basically looked at a couple of different images that were of the crying heart, and I designed something kind of by mishmashing all of them together, and I did a little doodle, as you can see here, combining a couple of different elements from a few different designs that I found on Instagram and online, and I just sat and spent an afternoon embroidering this collar. I embroidered it before it was constructed, so I just embroidered on the top piece of the collar, and I then sewed the entire collar together, so the collar stand underneath there and everything was all sewn after the embroidery had been done. And I'm really, really happy with it. They're not quite identical. What's it they say about eyebrows? They are their sisters, not twins. That is very much the case with these little ladies, these little hearts. But I am really, really happy with how they turned out. I used embroidery floss. The red, I think I used a triple strand in order to get the thickness of the red. And then I used a single strand for the detail embroidery of the face, so of the eyes, the eyebrows, the nose and the mouth. And I just love them. I think it's come out really, 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 really well. And I know that that's kind of blowing my own trumpet, but I love little details like this, and I was just thrilled at how it came together. I also added a little detail on the back of the collar because I couldn't resist. I embroidered a tiny little red heart on the back, right smack bang in the middle. So even if you're just seeing the back of the dress, you will get just a little touch of the embroidery detail. And it did take a little while to do this. I am a bit silly when it comes to kind of fun details. I go a little bit overboard. So in terms of the rest of the dress, I haven't really done all that much. It still doesn't have a skirt on it. I am just drafting the skirt myself. There are no pattern pieces included for the skirt. I'm still debating whether or not to add pockets, but I think I probably will. But essentially it's going to be a gathered skirt, which is going to be a couple of big rectangles gathered down. So it's not that complicated in order to do that, but yes, I need to draft the skirt, cut it out, sew in the pockets, attach the skirt to this, buy some buttons, sew the buttonholes, and then this dress will be finished. And I'm really excited because it's so cute. But yeah, I really love the Pauline Alice pattern as a base for it. I think their customer service is wonderful. I think it's great that they've improved the older pattern to include this version. And yeah, basically that is one of the big projects that I've been working on over the past week. Huzzah! The last project that I have to share with you is very excitingly actually a finished object. I am a little bit overwhelmed that I finished this in the past week, and this is really where the majority of my time has gone, I think. And I'm just gonna grab it and share it with you because it's really exciting. So I have it on a hanger because it's all finished and kind of ironed and pressed and ready to go. But this, guys, is my finished dress. Now, I am gonna hopefully do some close-ups and insert those for you because I can't really show the whole dress. Look, there it is in the video, just because it's a relatively small setup, isn't it? But yes, this is the main thing that I have been working on over the past week. And the reason that I've been working on it is that I want to wear this dress at my baby shower, which is not going to be this current weekend, but the next weekend. So I didn't have that much time to get it done, and I didn't want to be kind of right up to the wire in terms of finishing it, as I so often am when it comes to sewing projects. So I wanted to get it finished in good time. So it's already completely done, which is kind of insane and amazing, but I'm really, really happy with how it turned out. And yeah, I want to talk a little bit about this pattern specifically. Now, I'm currently 7 months pregnant. I don't know if I've mentioned the pregnancy enough in this video so far, but that is such is the reality of my life. It comes up when we're talking about making projects for my body, which is currently 7 months pregnant. But basically, when I was searching for patterns that were suitable for a pregnant body that weren't necessarily maternity patterns, because I like the idea of making things that have longevity that I will be able to wear after pregnancy, because for all I know, this may be the one and only time that I'm ever pregnant. We never know about these things. I looked on the Deer & Doe website because I'm a massive fan of Deer & Doe. If you don't know, they're one of my favourite independent pattern companies, and they suggested this particular dress. Now, forgive me for all of my French-speaking viewers. I'm so sorry because I always butcher these names. I believe the name is Aubepine. Not entirely sure. I'm so sorry, but this is the pattern, and essentially, it is an Empire line dress, which has a kind of gathering around just underneath the bust. And they suggest this as a maternity pattern because you don't need to adapt it at all in order for it to fit you when you're pregnant, because it's Empire line and because it has that alteration around the just below the bust. It means that you can just adjust it to whatever size you are. So it's an incredibly versatile dress. And I'm just really happy that I made it because it fits like an absolute dream. Now, forgive me I'm not actually going to be wearing this dress on the podcast because I made it specifically for my baby shower, and I kind of feel weird about wearing it before the baby shower. I don't know why. I feel like I'm almost jinxing something if I do that. Total, you know, silliness, but I'd like to keep it special for that, but I will show you some kind of close-ups of it hanging up. So let me talk you through some of the construction details of this dress because it really is a beautiful project. One of my absolute favourite details about this dress, and one of the reasons that I was drawn to the pattern initially, which to be honest, I think it looks nice, but it didn't necessarily have a huge amount of, say, curb appeal when I initially saw the pattern. But one of the things that really drew me in were the little pleat details which are around the bust of the dress. Now, these details are so cute. So if you can see here, it has three little pleats that run across the entirety of the bust. And those pleats are also mirrored on the sleeves. So you can see just here, those three little pleats. I think that's a beautiful detail. And although it's slightly lost because the fabric that I have used is very, very highly patterned, I think it looks beautiful. And sewing these was a real joy. You may have seen this fabric on my Instagram. I basically hand stitched these pleats before I sewed them on the sewing machine. So a little bit of hand stitching was involved with this project, which makes me very happy because I love hand stitching. It makes me so calm and it makes me feel very collected and very at peace, and it's kind of therapeutic. So to be able to do that on this dress was really, really fun. Let me talk about this fabric quickly. I actually bought this fabric in two different colours because I loved it so much when I initially saw it. I bought it from an incredible online shop here in the UK, which is Sew Me Sunshine UK. I love everything that they stock. They have a really interesting turnover of fabrics. And this is a rayon fabric, which is by both Cotton and Steel and Rifle Paper Co. And it's kind of obvious why I picked this fabric, to be fair, because it's all the colours that I love in autumn. The background is kind of a brownish burgundy, and then there are accents of pink, orange and white, and then tiny little sprinklings of blue in there as well, and dark green leaves, and this kind of olivey colour that's almost gold, and I love it. It's so pretty. It's so lovely. So this project is also fully lined. So I'm going to take it off its little hanger so I can show you the lining. Very excitingly, I used this silk fabric to line the whole dress, this pink silk. I'm not usually one for using kind of real luxury fabrics inside linings of dresses. I am so glad I did with this. This against the skin feels incredible, and for someone who isn't always 100% happy in their skin at the moment, because my body is changing so much on an almost day-to-day basis, having something so soft and luxurious against my skin makes me feel amazing. So I'm really, really happy that I put this in. I finished it with understitching around the neckline. I did use the same colour stitching as the main colour of the dress. I maybe should have done it in pink, but I don't mind it. It's not horrifically offensive to me. And it's also lined on the inside of the skirt. So both the bodice and the skirt are lined in this beautiful fabric. And yeah, very, very, very happy with that. It has this detailing around the waist, which basically involves you sewing a channel which has ribbon in it in order for it to adjust under the bust line. You also have two different options for sleeves. I went for the longer sleeve because I just thought they look really, really pretty, and those are finished with a little bit of elastic just to add. I feel like it has a slightly more peasant dress feel, and I feel like with this fabric that really, really works, but it's so pretty and I love it so much, and it's such a joy to make something that I know 100% is going to fit me even after I have the baby, because I put a lot of work into this dress, a lot of hours of hand stitching and pressing and really just making sure that everything was perfect, mostly because it is for a pretty special event, and I wanted it to look really good, but also because I felt that I just needed to give a lot of myself to a really special project, and that's what this has ended up being. So I'm really, really happy with it. I get a little bit emotional when I try it on, actually, because this is one of the first things that I've worn since being pregnant and having a very, very drastically changed body that still makes me feel really beautiful. So obviously, when I actually wear it, I will take video, I will take photos, I will share that with you, because it's something that I'm really, really excited about, and I think it's going to look great, so I definitely want to share that with you guys, but forgive me for waiting just a little bit longer until I do that, so I can keep it as a special dress for a special occasion. But yes, I love the pattern. Deer and Doe, you did it again. I have yet to meet a Deer and Doe pattern that I haven't fallen in love with when I've ended up sewing it and wearing it, so that is great. My only gripe, to be fair, with Deer and Doe is that they don't have a massively extended pattern size. To put it into perspective, I do fall in the top section of Deer and Doe sizing, and I am by no means a really like big person. I'm just average, so it does make me kind of think, maybe you should extend your sizing just a little bit, Deer and Doe. That would be great. But in terms of their pattern production, I do think that all of their designs are wonderful. They really do appeal to me on a very, very deep level, and I'm pretty sure this is going to be a firm favourite for me, so yay! I can't believe I finished this and it's fully lined and all done and just ready to go. I don't think I've ever had a dress for an event finish this early, because this is literally finished with a week before the event, and that is just, I've never done that. I can honestly say I've never done that, so well done, brain, for allowing me to do that this week. And yeah, I can't wait to wear it and obviously share it with you after the fact. Well guys, that's pretty much everything from me this week. I feel like it's been a very productive sewing week. I do have the best of intentions to get a lot of stuff done over the next week as well. So fingers crossed, I'll have even more bits and pieces to share with you for next week's episode, and hopefully a little bit more knitting, you never know. But I hope you all have a wonderful week. I hope it's filled with whatever brings you joy, be it sewing, knitting, crochet, weaving, whatever. Just fill your hearts with happiness. From me to you, I'm sending you so much love. And I will see you again really, 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 really soon. Bye!